Good morning, everyone. Very happy to be here. Sharonda and I are very excited to be here today. We are thrilled to have so many attendees today, and I think that your interest in this presentation serves as a testament to the importance of what we will be discussing today. So we're very excited. Want to start off with a couple housekeeping notes. We do have a Q&A question box, so please do submit your questions. Now, given the size of the presentation and the amount of material we're going to be covering, we most likely will not have the opportunity to respond to all the questions individually during the presentation, but we will do our best to follow up via email with any questions that we don't answer here today at the presentation. So please do submit your questions. As the housekeeping notes say, we're going to have a PDF of the presentation is going to be available, and that will be emailed. And please do provide your feedback and also follow us on social media, including Twitter. All right. I want to jump into the agenda today. First, we're going to give a little bit of a background on an overview of the National Labor Relations Act, sort of set the stage for our presentation and give in a little background information for anybody who's needs a little refresher. Then we're going to give some general predictions for the NLRB under the Biden administration, talk about some recent union organizing efforts, also expected changes to the work-based policies under the Biden administration, and we'll conclude by talking about the Protecting the Right to Organize Act, also known as the PRO Act, which is some legislation that's that pending in Congress that we all need to be well aware of and know about. So the first question is, am I covered by the NLRA? Are the employers and their employees covered by the NLRA? And as it says here, chances are yes. The NLRA, that's the National Labor Relations Act, that applies to most private sector employers, and it also covers most employees in the private sector. And it's very important to understand that the NLRA applies both in union and non-union workplaces. So even if you don't have any unions in your workplace, there's still NLRA coverage. Now, the NLRA does not apply to federal, state, or local governments, employers who employ only agricultural workers, and employers subject to the Railway Labor Act. The NLRA does not cover government employees, agricultural laborers, independent contractors, and supervisors, with some limited exceptions to that, including supervisors that have been discriminated against for refusing to violate the NLRA. Those supervisors may be covered. So employee rights under the NLRA. Obviously, the NLRA protects union activity. So attempting to form a union, trying to get rid of the union, decertify the union, join a union, or the right to assist the union in organizing workers, those are all covered by the NLRA. But also, outside the presence of a union, there's this concept called concerted activity, which is protected under the NLRA. And that is an important concept that we want to spend a little time on today. So just so you understand kind of the structure of the NLRA, and so when you oftentimes you'll hear about Section 7 rights versus Section 8 rights, just so you have a basis of what they're talking about in that situation. Section 7 of the NLRA protects employees' rights to use unions to collectively bargain, engage in concerted activities, organize, and also to refrain from those activities if that's their preference. And then Section 8 of the NLRA prevents employers from coercing, restraining, or interfering in employees' exercise of those Section 7 rights. The National Labor Relations Act protects the rights of employees to engage in concerted activity. And this is what we've been talking about a little bit. And what is concerted activity? It's when two or more employees take action for the mutual aid or protection regarding terms and conditions of employment. A single employee may also engage in protected concerted activity if he or she is acting on the authority of other employees, bringing group complaints to the employer's attention, or trying to induce group action, or seeking to prepare for group action. Now, on March 31st, 2021, the Acting General Counsel of the NLRB the National Labor Relations Board. His name is Peter Orr. He issued a new enforcement memorandum, and in that memorandum, he takes a very expansive view of concerted activities under the NLRA. And I just want to, you know, highlight some parts of this memorandum. I think it's a very interesting memorandum, and I would encourage you, if you have the time, to take a look at it. It's not very long, and it's very readable, in my opinion. I mean, I think it's kind of written not for lawyers, but sort of to give the public a sense of where, you know, the National Labor Relations Board is going to be headed under the Biden administration. So I think if you have the time to take a look at it, it will give you a good flavor for where the board is heading. You know, it says here that as a consequence of the COVID pandemic, health and safety issues have unfortunately become more prevalent at the workplace. This memorandum focuses on protecting employees' fundamental rights by examining the interrelated framework of basic yet pivotal legal constructs. And flash forward to a little bit further on in the memorandum where Mr. Orr, he says, I look forward to robustly enforcing the Act's provisions that protect employee Section 7 rights with full knowledge that recent decisions, so the recent decisions, of course, have been under the NLRB under the Trump administration. So the recent decisions issued by the current board have restricted those protections. So, you know, Mr. Orr is taking the view that the decisions that have come out of the NLRB under the Trump administration have restricted the protections afforded under Section 7 of the NLRA. And he highlights two opinions. He says, notably, the two majority opinions in two decisions, Allstate Maintenance and Quicken Loans, have applied this mutual aid or protection concept narrowly. So that's the current acting general counsel of the NLRB. That's his view of the current situation. Now, you know, I've referred to him as the acting general counsel. So obviously there's supposed to be a permanent general counsel, and her name, President Biden has nominated Jennifer Abruzzo to fill that position. And her confirmation proceedings are pending. There's been some issues with the way that the past general counsel was removed from office. Typically, the practice has been to allow the general counsel that's in place to, finish their term. And he had about 10 more. His name was Peter Robb. He had about 10 more months on his term. And President Biden asked for his resignation. He refused, and then he was fired. So that's caused some issues that are holding up Jennifer Abruzzo's confirmation. And in the meantime, you know, Peter Orr has said that he's not going to just sit by as a potted plant and not take any action in his position as acting general counsel. So, you know, that memorandum is important because until Jennifer Abruzzo, you know, takes over, Peter Orr, the author of that memorandum, is in charge. And so it's important to understand what his views are. Now, Jennifer Abruzzo is probably going to take a similar position on a lot of those issues, but I'm sure she'll, you know, have her own announcements to make. So that takes us to the first polling question we have. And I'm going to read the polling question to you, and I'd like you to, you know, click on an answer if you'd like to. The polling question is, which of the following is not an example of concerted activity? And so we have several choices here. The first choice, A, is two or more employees addressing their employer about improving their pay. B is two or more employees discussing work-related issues beyond pay, such as safety concerns with each other. Choice C is discussing terms and conditions of employment with coworkers and outsiders, including the media. D is speaking out on behalf of coworkers. E is soliciting others to join in group action, such as a class or collective action. And F, one employee complaining to a manager about the possibility of not getting a tip where the complaint is made in front of other employees. Okay, so which of the following is not an example of concerted activity? One more second to take a look here. We've gotten a lot of responses, which we appreciate. And okay, I'm going to go ahead and look at the results. All right, and yeah, 84%. You guys are right. Choice F is the correct choice, and choice F is from a relatively recent 2019 opinion. That's the Allstate maintenance case, and if that case name sounds familiar, that's because that's taken out of that memorandum, which I just referenced, where Peter Orr is saying that those concerted activity rights were construed very narrowly. So, you know, you could be safe to assume that that type of decision might not be coming under the Biden administration once the Biden board is put into place. Now, I see in the question box here, one of the questions we got is, where can we find this memorandum? And if you just Google, you know, Peter Orr memorandum, or the specific name of the memorandum is Memorandum GC21-03. They're available on the NLRB website, but if you just Google, you know, Peter Orr Memorandum GC21-03, you should come up with a link to it. And if not, just reach out. I'm happy to forward you a copy of that memorandum if anyone has trouble finding it. All right. So we've got some predictions now under the for the NLRB under the Biden administration. President Biden has been described as a very pro-labor president. He's put forward a new task force to look at the ways that the government can help support organized labor. He issued a fact sheet with regards to the task force that him and the vice president are heading up. And this fact sheet that was issued on April 26, 2021 says, the president and vice president believe that the decline of union membership is contributing to serious societal and economic problems in our country, widespread and deep economic inequality, stagnant real wages, and the shrinking of America's middle class are all associated with the declining percentage of workers represented by unions. So you can see from that language, I mean, they're ascribing some large-scale problems to the decline in union membership, and that's a connection that not a lot of people may make. And so you can see that that's the position of the White House. So, you know, they're serious about what they're doing. So you can expect that the White House is going to be supporting, you know, developing union, organizing unions, and trying to increase union membership. So some specific predictions. One prediction is that the employees will be able to use employer email systems to organize unions. Currently, that's not allowed. And the thought is that under the Biden NLRB board, you know, once that gets into place, that's a change that might be on the horizon. Another change that might be on the horizon is the removal of some restrictions on non-employee union organizer access to employee property to organize. Currently, there's some restrictions in place on that, and we would expect to see that those restrictions loosened under the Biden board. So stay tuned for those changes. As I said, you know, President Biden obviously came into office in January, and so the turnover of the board is not, you know, he doesn't come in and get to remove everyone off the NLRB. It's the different chairs or the different positions on the NLRB are sort of, the terms are staggered a little bit so that it's not a wholesale change. But by August, the expectation is that it's going to be a pro-union board, and so you can expect maybe some of those changes coming if the appropriate cases are brought to the board so that those changes can be made. Okay, I want to talk a little bit about union organizing efforts. I'm sure some of you are familiar with this. It made quite a bit of news, but in November, one of Amazon's facilities, distribution facility in Alabama, held a big union vote. And, you know, Amazon had a good approach for educating the workers so that they could each make informed decisions, and also advising the employees what would happen, you know, if a union came into place, and what some predictions were, you know, that could potentially happen if a union was installed there. And so on April 9th, 2021, workers for Amazon in Alabama voted by an overwhelming majority to remain union free. So that was a big win for employers, a big high profile situation. And of course, we're already seeing challenges to this. And one of the grounds for the challenges concerns this mailbox that was on the grounds. Who had access to the mailbox, and a lot of issues surrounding that. It's probably going to be you know, something that we'll see some more news on in the coming weeks and months for sure. But you know, I think that this news sort of invigorated unions, and you know, you got a lot of press about it, a lot of people talking about it on social media. So you know, you can expect more of the same, certainly with the support of the White House and the direction the NLRB is going. You can expect more union organizing efforts across the country. The contract bar doctrine, this is something I just wanted to mention. There was a decision that came out on this earlier this year. And the contract bar doctrine is a rule that's in place to prevent, you know, switching of a union when a current union is already in place, talking about having an election petition for a different union to come in. And you know, the NLRB invited some discussion on this topic to see if it was time to change that rule. And people were expecting that maybe there was going to be a change in the rule. And the NLRB looked at that in this Mountain Farms decision. Mountain Air Farms decision, and decided that there was going to be no change at this time. So it's a relatively, you know, minor point, but it was something I just wanted to highlight because it was kind of some big news coming out of the traditional, you know, labor circles that we wanted to highlight for you. So now we're going to start talking a little bit about workplace policies, and that's a big piece of this presentation, is to give you some information about workplace policies that you know, might be changing under the NLRB with under the Biden NLRB. So during the Obama administration, the NLRB expansively applied the NLRA in review and consideration of facially neutral workplace policies and procedures. And then in December of 2017, the NLRB came out with this Boeing decision and provided us with a new test. Now, importantly, the current NLRB's new chair, she dissented in the Boeing decision when it came out. So you can kind of get a sense of what her view was on this issue from what her dissent was in that Boeing case. And in March 2021, Peter Orr, who's the acting general counsel that we mentioned previously, he expressed his view that, which is not a surprise to, you know, to a lot of people. He expressed his view that the Boeing decision did not square with the National Labor Relations Act, the language of that act. And so employers should expect a return to the pre-Boeing standard at some point during the Biden administration. And so let's talk a little bit about that pre-Boeing or President Obama era standard. So the case that you need to look at is the Lutheran Heritage Village case, and that's a 2004 case. And in that situation, the test that was used is whether or not the workplace rules would reasonably tend to chill an employee from engaging in protective activity. So could the rule be read in a way that could reasonably tend to chill an employee from engaging in protected activity? And so under the standard, even if the rule was facially neutral, it was illegal if an employee could reasonably construe the policy as restricting his or her NLRA rights. So it wasn't important what the employee actually thought at the time or how that individual employee read it. It's whether or not it reasonably could be read that way. And so as a result, a lot of the very standard employee handbook provisions were put on the chopping block without any consideration or justification or reasoning behind the rule. And, you know, employment lawyers like myself and Sharonda can remember this time very well. You know, you're just going through the handbooks and circling anything that could, you know, in your view, possibly, you know, be construed as something that could reasonably tend to chill an employer or an employee from engaging in those protected rights. So it was an interesting time, and we might be going back there at some point, unfortunately. And so now under the Boeing standard, it's a different rule, and the rule is that it's a standard now that takes into account what's the actual justifications for the rule. And so the standard balances what's the nature and extent of the potential impact on the NLRA rights caused by this policy, but it also is then going to balance that with what's the legitimate justifications associated with the rule. So it provides a little bit more of an employer-friendly standard. And when the employer's legitimate justifications for the rule outweigh its potential impact on employees' rights, then the rule may be considered lawful. And so, of course, you may remember that Peter Robb, who was the former general counsel of the NLRB, he put out a memorandum that some people found to be very helpful, in which employers could look at, and it had, you know, the different rules broken into three different categories, where it said these rules are always going to be unlawful, these rules you have to look at on each case-by-case scenario, and then these other rules are always going to be found lawful. So it was a helpful thing in some people's view. And one of the first things that Peter Orr did when he got into office was he rescinded that memorandum. And he said, you know, a lot of these classifications that this memorandum is advising employers on are not based on actual NLRB decisions. So rather in engaging in this speculative thinking, let's go ahead and let the NLRB issue some opinions on these things, and we'll give them some real – will give employers some actual guidance from the NLRB, which of course is fine. However, for employers, rather than, you know, having to test out these different policies through going through the NLRB process, you'd prefer to have, you know, some advice from the NLRB giving you some direction. But that was the decision that was made. So now we have one more polling question that we'd like to ask you. And this question says, which of the following code of conduct provisions are unlawful under the pre-Boeing standard? Choice A is provisions prohibiting verbal comments or physical gestures directed at others that exceed the bounds of fair criticism. B is provisions prohibiting behavior that is counter to promoting teamwork. C is both of these provisions, or D is neither of these provisions. Let me read that one more time. Which of the following code of conduct provisions are unlawful under the pre-Boeing standard? Again, this is the standard, the pre-Boeing standard, that we may be going back to soon. So that's why it's important. Can you give a little bit more time to get a couple more people a chance to answer this? All right, let's go ahead and advance the slide so we can see what the results are. Both provisions. That's right. We've got a very astute group with us today, Sharonda. They're up on their NLRB cases. This was taken from a case in which an administrative law judge or ALJ found that both of these provisions could reasonably be interpreted as prohibiting lawful discussions or complaints that are protected by Section 7 of the NLRA. So that's right. Choice C is the correct choice here. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Sharonda.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Thanks again for joining us. You know, we call this the ping pong effect when we go from one, for instance, Republican administration to a Democratic and more progressive leaning administration. And it's exciting and it is a fun time for us. But we do have the benefit of what we saw under the Obama administration. And as Chris discussed, we think that what we will see now will greatly mirror and probably expand what we saw previously. And so as we discuss handbook policies and employment policies and procedures, I thought it might be helpful to go back to what we saw specifically called out under the Obama administration. And as Chris said, you know, we've already seen the Biden administration rescind that GC memorandum, which basically said that, you know, the prior administration's handling of handbook policies and procedures was wrong. So we do expect that we will go back to this kind of analysis. So one thing that that, you know, could easily set off censors under an Obama administration and probably will again under a Biden are any kind of confidentiality policies. And what we saw a lot of was that, you know, if you were doing an investigation or if you had something that the employer deemed to be confidential or proprietary information, we could advise that, you know, it's okay to tell your employees not to discuss certain things, that this is confidential. We're asking you to keep it confidential. Please don't discuss it. Well, then we saw under the Obama administration that that kind of policy or procedure could be interpreted to cool Section 7 rights. The justification we saw was, what if these employees are discussing issues that touch terms and conditions of employment? So to say that they have to keep that confidential could potentially chill their Section 7 rights. And so we saw that expanded into a lot of policies that we thought, you know, were totally justifiable. So, for instance, and I'd like to start by looking at what they said were permissible policies, because I think that's helpful for us to really put it in context. So they said, you know, a policy that says do not disclose confidential financial data or other non-public proprietary company information. Do not share confidential information regarding business partners, vendors, or customers. Well, you can see how that is very closely linked to the company's proprietary information. So if you've got a policy that's saying you cannot disclose our actual proprietary information, that is probably going to be okay. Now, of course, the catch there is that you've got to actually be talking about something that's proprietary. It's not something that, you know, you think is just your confidential information. And one clear example might be, say, you know, your Coca-Cola. Your formula for, you know, making Coca-Cola is going to be proprietary. And so if you've got a policy that you cannot disclose that, that's going to be okay. Again, you can see no unauthorized disclosure of business secrets or other confidential information. Now, that one was deemed okay. I'm a little bit nervous about the or other confidential information because I think that gets a little, that could be a little bit of a gray area. But again, we saw that they said that that kind of policy was generally going to be okay. And then prohibition on disclosure of all information acquired in the course of one's work. Again, I would be a little bit nervous about that one, but they said that that one probably wouldn't cross the line. Now, let's look at what they deemed impermissible confidentiality policies. So you must not disclose proprietary or confidential information about the employer or other associates. And that's where we got into the issue that if the associates are talking about something that relates to their terms or conditions of employment, and it happens to touch on what you say is your confidential financial information, so obviously wages, any kind of benefits information, then that was deemed impermissible because it could chill their right to engage in protected concerted activity. Another one that is likely deemed impermissible is if something is not public information, you must not share it. Well, even if it's not public information, but it's part, especially if it's part of a campaign, if it's part of organizing activity, I anticipate that the new labor board, once everybody gets installed, is going to have an issue with that kind of broad ban on sharing something that's not quote unquote public information. And you can see, do not discuss customer or employee information outside of work, including phone numbers and addresses. And those of you who have dealt with organizing activity before can probably already guess the issue there. One main issue is that if employees or union members are trying to organize, they are going to need employee information. It's not that there isn't a line, but you've got to be very careful about the fact that it's got to be something that is actually proprietary or actually some kind of confidential information. Employee conduct towards employees and supervisors. Again, this one is one that's really tough for employers to deal with because, you don't want employees who are engaging in insubordination. And again, those of you who've dealt with this before know that that's going to be a hot button word, insubordination. But let's look at what was deemed permissible under the Obama administration. So no rudeness or unprofessional behavior toward a customer or anyone in contact with the company. So anytime, I think this is a great example because I think anytime you can link it to your actual customer or the more that you can link your policy to your actual customer or clients, you're going to have more protection. No matter how progressive the labor board gets, no matter how progressive the administration gets, they understand that you cannot be offending your customers. That is not going to be okay. So if somebody spouts off on Facebook about how, we have terrible customers who don't like to clean up and, make my job awful, even if there's a way to connect that somehow to protected concerted activity or some kind of organizing, that is probably not going to be protected activity. Another permissible example, each employee is expected to work in a cooperative manner with management, supervision, coworkers, customers, and vendors. That one, I think because it's focusing more on creating a cooperative workplace, there's not necessarily a prohibition there. They're not saying you're not allowed to engage in XYZ conduct. It's just that we expect you to work in a cooperative manner. That's likely permissible. Each employee is expected to abide by company policies and to cooperate fully in any investigation that the company may undertake. Again, you're not prohibiting anything, and you're not saying that somebody is going to be disciplined or punished for XYZ behavior. You are just saying that our employees are expected to abide by our policies and cooperate in investigations. Now let's look at impermissible, because I think this is equally helpful. These were policies deemed impermissible regarding employee conduct under the Obama board. Be respectful to the company, other employees, customers, partners, and competitors. So the red flag here is respectful. If you've got language in your policy that includes stuff like be respectful, again, insubordinate, do not engage in insubordination, it just tends to be a gray area. And often in very contentious organizing climates, and you will see behavior that may not be respectful or what you or I may deem respectful, but it's geared towards improving the employee's terms or conditions of employment, presumably. So that was why that set off a red flag. And honestly, even now, even under the Trump administration, I advise clients to stay away from that kind of language saying be respectful, because it just is such a gray area. Another potentially impermissible policy, chronic resistance to proper work-related orders or discipline, even though not overt insubordination, will result in discipline. Again, you've got insubordination, which is going to be a red flag because oftentimes organizing activity could be deemed or is closely aligned with what an employer might consider insubordination. And again, you've got here, it's not like we saw in the permissible policies where it's encouraging cooperation or it's expecting you to abide by policies. You're saying, you know, something that could be deemed insubordination will result in discipline. And then finally, never engage in behavior that would undermine the reputation of the employer, your peers, or yourself. And reputation here is a red flag. There is plenty of organizing activity that could be deemed to undermine an employer's reputation. If, you know, employees are advocating for better wages, if they're advocating for better benefits, you all who saw the Amazon organizing activity saw, you know, a lot of the media content about what was going on at Amazon and about Jeff Bezos personally. So within the lines of organizing activity or engaging in protected concerted activity, there may well be some behavior that an employer could deem to undermine the employer's reputation or the peer's reputation. And so that's the issue with that kind of policy. And the bottom line there is that policies that ban false statements were even deemed unlawfully overbroad unless they specified that only maliciously false statements were prohibited. You know, look out for anything that, again, that says respectful or that talks in terms of insubordination. Employee conduct towards other employees. Here we're looking at, again, how closely can you tailor the policy to the behavior that you are actually trying to prevent. So permissible policies, something like no harassment of employees, patients, or facility visitors. I don't care how progressive the board is. I don't care, you know, how progressive they are. They're not going to deem that kind of policy impermissible. You can prohibit harassment of your employees, your patients, and your facility visitors. And in fact, you have an obligation to do so. So I wouldn't be worried about any policy that says no harassment. And you may be thinking, you know, harassment can be kind of a gray area term as well. What do we mean by harassment? And you may take it a step further in your policy to define what you mean by harassment. But from an overall employment law perspective, it is always a good policy to have an anti-harassment policy. And the labor board is not going to interfere with that. Another potentially permissible policy, no threatening, intimidating, coercing, or otherwise interfering with the job performance of fellow employees or visitors. So as specific as you can get about, you know, do not threaten your coworkers. We're not going to tolerate intimidation of coworkers or visitors. All that kind of stuff is going to be okay. Now this one is a little bit, less clear, but it's probably okay. No making inappropriate gestures, including visual staring. I'm a little bit nervous about inappropriate, but under the Obama administration, that was deemed okay. But there we're looking at, you know, no offensive gestures. And again, as long as it's specifically tied to the conduct that you were trying to prohibit as far as protecting from, you know, any kind of hostile work environment, issues, it's probably going to be okay. Impermissible policies, something like don't pick fights online. And these are all, you know, when we got this extensive handbook memorandum under the Obama administration, these were taken from real examples. So I would think that now many of you don't have a policy that says something like don't pick fights online, but you can guess why that would be problematic, because again, a lot of times protected concerted activity or organizing activity involves a social media campaign, So an employee might get online and say, you know, Amazon or whoever it may be, you know, refuses to pay its employees a living wage. And that may, you know, lead to some kind of discussion. And again, we don't know. Lots of people can interpret pick fights in many different ways. Another one that may be deemed impermissible is do not make insulting, embarrassing, hurtful, or abusive comments about other company employees online, and avoid the use of offensive, derogatory, or prejudicial comments. Now, again, this one, you know, I think there is a way to draft this that is probably permissible, and that, you know, because you're not allowed to, an employer is not going to permit you to harass your employees online, even if it's just on social media. But I think this one gets a little bit blurrier because it says insulting, hurtful, or abusive comments, and then it says, you know, avoid the use of prejudicial comments. I think it just gets a little bit mushier as far as what is considered abusive, what is considered prejudicial. You might need, in the course of protected concerted activity, you might write on there, write online, you know, my supervisors refuse to give us the breaks that we need. So that one, I think, is a little bit stickier. And then finally, you can probably guess why this one is problematic. Show proper consideration for others' privacy and for topics that may be considered objectionable or inflammatory, such as politics and religion. Well, that is the heart of any protected concerted activity, especially any union organizing campaign, is going to be discussion of topics that could be considered objectionable or inflammatory. So anything that's going to, you know, any policy that talks in terms of, you know, don't discuss topics that could be objectionable is probably going to be impermissible. Also, show proper consideration. I mean, we just don't know what that means. Is, you know, if I go online and say, you know, XYZ employer won't pay its people a living wage, you know, we might say that's not proper consideration for somebody's privacy. But, you know, in the world of the NLRA, that may be protected activity. And so the bottom line for this category of policies is that under the NLRA, employees have a right to argue and debate with each other about unions, management, and terms and conditions of employment. So, you know, these discussions can become contentious. They can become objectionable. You know, they can involve what we might say it's, you know, derogatory or prejudicial comments. You know, under Obama, they basically concluded that employers couldn't ban this kind of negative or inappropriate discussions without some kind of further clarification. So again, you have a legitimate interest in keeping harassment out of the workplace, but when you start saying things like don't get in fights with coworkers online, it's a little bit harder to justify. And you'll see, you know, you can kind of see the same theme here, which is employee conduct towards third parties, right? So, you know, when we talk about employees or supervisors, we want to be clear that what we're trying to protect against is some kind of harassment against our employees or that kind of stuff. And when it comes to third parties, you know, we just have to be careful that employees can use certain communications as part of their protected activity or organizing activity. So impermissible policies that we saw or policies that we saw deemed impermissible under the Obama administration. Employees are not authorized to speak to any representatives of the print and or electronic media about company matters unless designated to do so by HR and must refer all media inquiries to the company media hotline. Now, that I know that gives us all some heartburn because, you know, we want to make sure that people aren't out there speaking for the company and saying things that are totally untrue. But, you know, again, as Chris mentioned, it's going to be a balancing test. And when we've got an all-out ban on speaking to any representative of print or electronic media about quote-unquote company matters, that's harder to justify. And certainly this policy, if you are contacted by any government agency, you should contact the law department immediately for assistance. Well, we see, even outside of the NLRA context, we see employees who are contacted by government agencies all the time. I mean, they might file an EEOC charge. They may be communicating with the EEOC without our knowledge. And typically, any bar against contacting a government agency is gonna raise a red flag. Permissible policies. Now, this one you can see is drafted a little bit more narrowly. The company strives to anticipate and manage crisis situations in order to reduce disruption to our employees and to maintain our reputation as a high-quality company. To best serve these objectives, the company will respond to the news media in a timely and professional manner only through the designated spokesperson. So you see again this trend of not necessarily prohibiting certain behavior, but encouraging behavior, right? This, the reason that, you know, we have a spokesperson is because we want to manage crisis situations and reduce disruption to our employees and maintain our reputation. So we have a representative who is going to be our designated spokesperson. But it's not this that we saw before, prohibition, this absolute prohibition that you're not allowed to speak to anybody from the media about anything with the company. So the more narrowly that we can draw these policies, the better off or the more justifiable they will be. Okay, let's look at just a couple more of these policies because I don't want to run out of time for questions. I'm going to try and move a little bit quicker. So logos, copyrights, and trademarks. Let's just look at the examples of impermissible policies. Use of the employer's name, address, or information in your personal profile is banned. In addition, it's prohibited to use the logos, trademarks, or any other copyrighted material. A similar one, do not use any company logos, trademarks, graphics, or advertising materials in social medias. Employees, the bottom line here is that the administration found that employees had a right to use the name and logo on picket signs, leaflets, other protest materials. So ultimately, proprietary interests, as far as they go with logos, copyrights, and trademarks, are implicated in the employee's non-commercial use of a name or a logo. So if they're not using it to sell t-shirts or products or something, but they're using it as part of their organizing activity, then that was deemed permissible for them to do. And so a policy that's a flat-out prohibition of using company logos, trademarks, or graphics is going to be likely deemed impermissible. Photography and recording. This one is always tricky too, because again, you've got proprietary interests. You know, a lot of times if you're a manufacturer and you've got, you know, your own processes for doing things, and that is your proprietary material, then you don't want people on the floor taking pictures of it. And this was one that we saw a lot of discussion and debate about under the Obama administration. So I want y'all to just be thinking about it. I want you to go look at what your policy says about photography and recording, so that you can be ready in case the tide changes again. You might have a policy before the Obama administration, we might have a policy that we thought was okay that said taking unauthorized pictures or video on company property is prohibited. Well, that costs a lot of issues. And again, the reason being that if the pictures or the video is in support of their concerted activity, then we can't have an all-out ban on it. If they're taking pictures of some unsafe working conditions, if they're taking videos of unsafe working conditions, then you know, that could be deemed their protected concerted activity. So that administration found that any handbook policies that placed a total ban on such photography or recordings were considered unlawfully overbroad. So especially if, and one way that you might narrow this is that if it didn't have if it didn't have some clarification that this rule is limited to working time, so no unauthorized pictures or videos during working time, that might be a justification that that helps support this kind of policy. Okay, walking off shift. again, you can't, what we're looking at here, so there's always got to be some nuance and some clarification. If anybody has a policy that says something like walking off the job is prohibited, we probably need to look at that. What is probably more, and the reason being, as you can guess, is that walking off the job is often a method of protected concerted activity. Especially during organizing, you might have a walkout, you might have, you may just have people walking off the job as part of a campaign or as part of organizing. So you can't, it is very risky to have a policy that has a flat out ban. What might be a better solution is to have something like entering or leaving company property without permission may result in discharge. And it may be as simple as having that little clause in there to say that this is not an all-out ban, but if you don't have permission and you walk off the job, it may result in discharge. And if it's for some reason involving protected concerted activity, then you need to probably get your HR people involved and or your legal counsel to evaluate whether that's a situation that should result in discharge. And finally, one last example of things to look out for, conflict of interest rules. So again, we've got this kind of wishy-washy gray area language in our sample and permissible policy. Employees may not engage in any action that is not in the best interest of the employer. Well, they may do a lot of things that we think are not in the best interest of the employer in the course of organizing activity or engaging in protected concerted activity. So that's just going to be a real red flag right there if you've got any action that's not in the employer's best interest. But you might, try and narrow that and say, I won't engage in activity that especially, such as avoid outside employment with an employer, customer, supplier, or competitor. Or having a significant financial interest with one of these entities. So I'm not going to do anything that's going to create a clear conflict of interest with one of our customers, but none of this, wishy-washy, don't do anything that's not in the employer's interest. That's going to be a red flag. However, these things are a case-by-case assessment. So that's why I said, just as we're entering into this next phase, this new administration, this is a great time to go back and look and see what your handbook actually says. And you may need to talk to your HR partners. You may need to talk to your legal counsel, whoever that is, to see if there are some things that you need to look at again under this new era that we're about to enter. So here's a recent example of where we can draw the line. So on May 13, 2021, the NLRB released a memo finding that a Trader Joe's employee's online rants directed at customers were not protected speech. So the employee said, just because we're open, this was all obviously in the context of COVID. So, employees are very, have been stressed as well. So just because we are open doesn't mean we're here for you to spend your time browsing around. We're designated as essential service. We're not here for you because you have nothing else to do. We're not here because you feel like getting out of the house for a while. We are in a state of emergency. This is not a vacation. Every customer who walks in our doors puts us at risk. We really don't want to be here, but we realize that we're needed. You don't see how many times a day we wash and sanitize our hands to try to keep ourselves safe. You don't see our upset coworkers in the break room struggling to keep their composure. You don't see our spouses who worry about us every minute we're at work and who are our strength when we get home. We have our jobs to do, and we realize the importance of our job to you. The least you can do is come in with a sense of purpose and get what you need and get yourselves home. So Trader Joe's fired this employee. He filed an unfair labor charge, unfair labor practice charge. And the NLRB said that this was not protected because of the disloyal, reckless, and maliciously untrue nature of the comments directed to the employer, and that these comments didn't have any nexus to any kind of labor dispute. There wasn't an organizing campaign. There wasn't any effort to get better pay or better wages. And so it just was an insult to customers over a normal shopping behavior. And so they said that that was not protected concerted activity. That was not protected speech. So again, if nothing else, just y'all go back and look at your handbook policies just so you know what they say. And so you know what to look out for as we move forward. So quickly, I'm going to go over the PRO Act, the Protecting the Right to Organize Act, which I say quickly because it's got a real uphill battle right now. It was introduced in February of 2021, passed the House on March 9th. It's been currently referred to the HELP Committee, but we think that it's just got a long road to go, and it may well not make it through the Senate. A similar bill was introduced in 2019 and died in the Senate. But this is a part of the new administration's overall shift to provide support to unions. And here's why. So some things that would change, and I'm sorry, y'all, if this slide is hard to read. We've got a lot of different colors in here. But it would expand the definition of employee. And that's important because the way that it would expand the definition of employee might start bringing in independent contractors. And so if you see a lot of talk about Uber, Lyft, all of these employers trying to, you know, put their weight behind not passing the PRO Act, it may be that this redefinition of employee is going to bring in a lot more people who are not previously covered. It's going to permit the creation of fair share agreements. And those are basically that'll be an attempt to get around right to work states. So as many of you probably know, Alabama, for instance, is a right to work state, which means that even if my employer unionizes, I do not have to join the union and I don't have to pay dues. Well, that's a big blow to unions who are potentially not collecting from a sizable portion of the workforce. So under the PRO Act, it'll allow employers and unions to enter into these fair share agreements where basically employees who are covered, who are under a unionized employer, will be paying the union fees, or they'll be able to collect union fees even if the employee doesn't want to participate in the union. It has lots of other provisions as well, but one of the biggest changes under this will be that, first of all, it'll allow a private right of action for employees who feel like they've had their rights violated, which means they can go to civil court, they can go to court and sue. And then it will also allow for some liability against directors, corporate directors or corporate officers who have engaged in behavior that constitutes an unfair labor practice or knew that unfair labor practices were occurring and didn't do anything to stop it. So you can imagine that's going to open up a lot of exposure for people who had not had any potential exposure before. If you had an unfair labor practice charge and you went to the NLRB for relief, you might get back pay, you might get reinstatement, but you're not going to go after the corporate directors and officers of the company. And under the PRO Act, you could. So there would be some potential liability there. So that was a quick rundown of some things that we want you all to be on the lookout for, some things you just might need to go back and review as far as your own policies and procedures. We have about 1 minute left, and so I know that there are a lot of questions that have been submitted, and I'll try to get to one or two of them, and I'll let Chris jump in as well, but for those that we don't have a chance to answer, we will do our best to follow up with you. So there's a question in here about, what about a policy that is considered job abandonment if an employee does not show up to work three shifts in a row? You know, that's common. It is, I would say it's going to be permissible. And I still advise clients who have policies that say, you know, 3-day no call, no show is going to result in termination. Now, the caveat there, as with any policy, is that you have to make sure it's being applied consistently. So if it's 3-day no call, no show, then that's what it is. It can't be used sometimes and then not used others. So that's always my caveat for any kind of policy like that, that you have to be careful that it is being applied consistently. Now, that aside, I think that that's going to be okay. Now, what you don't want in there is, you know, walking off the job anytime is going to result in termination. No, what may be better is, you know, 3-day no call, no show, which implies that the person has not gotten approval and that they have not put their employer on notice of the leave, is going to be subject to termination. So you just want to make sure that your policies are tailored in a way so that there's some room to allow for certain circumstances, special circumstances, but also that it is clear what the objective is. It's not that we're prohibiting people from walking off the job, but it's that, you know, if you don't come to work and you don't get approval and you don't tell us where you are for 3 days, then we're going to assume that you've abandoned your employment. Chris, did you want to add anything else?
Sure. There's one question here that I'll answer. It says, what are unions pushing for in 2021 during bargaining sessions due to COVID and the economy? And one of the things we're seeing, I talked to some colleagues about this one, is that, you know, look for unions to push for higher percentage wage increases based on this, you know, sort of mainstream assumption that economic conditions will continue to improve post-COVID. So that's something that we're seeing in these bargaining sessions. Anything else, Sharonda? I see that we're past our time, and I want to be respectful of everyone's schedules today. So unless there's anything else you want to say, I would invite everyone to submit their questions, and Sharonda or I or someone from our firm will get back to you on your questions. And otherwise, Sharonda, do you have anything?
I don't. And I also just want to be considerate of everyone's time. And thank you all so much for joining us today.
Thank you very much, everyone. Have a great day.